Lucy. Radio Cambridgeshire.
Now, I'm so excited to play you this interview. Back in 2010, a local photographer called Martin Bond started taking a photograph of Cambridge every day and putting it online. And now 11 years later, he's still doing it every single day. And his photos have become the most amazing collection and historical record of Cambridge. And of course, over the 11 years he's been doing it, they featured many residents of the city too.
I was born in Cambridge and really haven't left. And in about 11, in fact, it's almost exactly 11 years ago, I started a thing called a Cambridge Diary, which is a picture taken in Cambridge, and I publish it online on social media platforms like Facebook, Twitter,
sure,
and Instagram. And I'm a professional photographer, but this has now become my sort of my labour of love, and really sort of hoping that it will be the one that it'll be the thing that actually helps you to pay my mortgage as well.
So I'm interested to know how it all kind of began, because it started back in 2010, didn't it? And you've literally taken a portrait photo every day since then.
Yeah. I mean, really, it started for a couple of reasons. Really, one was that I was trying to encourage myself to turn the camera 90 degrees, which is why I called it a portrait. It's a play on words, if
okay.
You like. So to begin with, it was always a picture of somebody. There had to be some living thing in the picture. It was taken at, with the camera tilted to 90 degrees, because I was always sort of taking pictures, as everybody does, with the camera sort of level. And I thought, well, look, because I'm taking pictures of people, the portrait shape is much more sort of more like sort of a human shape.
Yeah.
I thought, well, look, let's see if we can do that for all the pictures. The second reason was that I noticed that that it was the sort of the town side of the city was never really being sort of explored or featured. If you Google Cambridge, all you get is pictures of King's College Chapel,
and
there's sort of those sort of evocative images of weeping willows over Punts. And there's an awful lot more to Cambridge than that. And being a sort of a townie myself, I thought, well, look, let's focus on that side of the city rather than on the university side. And really, it was just a case of me, having to discipline myself to take a picture on a regular basis. I decided to sort of do it for every day for 1 year,
right,
and post it on Facebook. And then at the end of the year, I couldn't stop, really.
So what was the first?
Carried on.
The first picture you took, was that kind of? Did you take it for the project, or was that kind of the catalyst for the project? Did you take it and think, "Oh, there's something in this. I could do this every day."
It was exactly that, Emily. I mean, I was actually using a lens that I was thinking about purchasing that I borrowed from Jessop's, which was in Green Street at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And they were very kind to me over there. They said, "Look, just take it out and just give it a road test." So I just walked around Trinity Street, and there was a guy up a ladder painting the ears of a shop, and just as I sort of raised my lens to take a picture of him, just to see how fast the focusing was or how I could frame it, he dropped some paint all over the floor and into his sandwich box on the pavement, and just to look the expression on his face, I captured it exactly the right time, and I thought, oh, I think I might be onto something here.
So
thank you to that painter and decorator for getting me started, because I just thought, I would like to try and get more of that, because it's more about, a moment in time.
Yeah, it sort of seems incredible that these perfect moments kind of happen in front of your lens. But is that the sort of point? Is that every day is kind of full of a million perfect moments if you're looking at it the right way and you can kind of capture something?
Well, that would be ideal, wouldn't it, Emily? I mean, if I could get, perfect moments every time. But, I mean, it's become quite an eclectic collection of the sort of the intricacies of the town, of the city. I mean, a good example is probably a couple of days ago, I posted actually more than one picture. It was one picture was a pair of peregrine falcons mating 200 foot, on the precipice of a church.
Wow.
Above me, which was definitely a moment in time. I also published a picture of a guy wearing a trilby and a raincoat, and the colours of his hat and his coat and his trousers matched perfectly the colour tones of the wall that he was walking by. And that was just a case of, I just love the colour palette of it.
Yeah.
Same day, a reflection of Gombling Keys in the window of Ryder and Amos, the sort of university outfitters. I had a picture of a chap a bearded guy sitting in a tractor cab reading Farmers Weekly, which I thought was a nice coming together. I had a picture of a lady who was photographing March hares in March.
Great.
And then a nice idyllic scene in Grantchester with the cast of the TV series drinking ale outside the Green Man pub, which obviously isn't open yet. I mean, it was just being done for the film. You know, that's about as eclectic as you can get, I think.
Yeah. So do you ever do you ever not feel like it? You know, do you ever wake up and think, oh, like not feeling well, or it's raining, and you've got to drag yourself out and do it? Or does it kind
Absolutely.
Of...
Yeah, I do. But I know that by doing it, I'm going to feel better.
Yeah.
You know, the process of I call it a human safari, really. You're going out there. You never really know what you're going to get. Mm. And there's a low-level excitement, if you like, that actually works well for my sort of well-being. You know, the very fact that actually I'm looking at other people and looking at other things rather than thinking about my own situation.
Yeah.
It gets you out of yourself literally, mentally, emotionally and physically.
Yeah.
And so it's a very, very good exercise. It's very meditative. And I think, you know, it's the one thing that's been keeping me sane really during the pandemic.
So do you have kind of like every day, say like today it's particularly windy, do you have in mind the sort of photo that you're after and then you sort of lurk for the perfect shot? Like, for example, you've got like, there's a lovely picture of a woman pulling a suitcase reflected in a puddle. So for that one, did you have to sort of focus on that puddle and wait for like the perfect thing to appear in it? Or
I mean, there are different techniques. I mean, street photographers have their own sort of way of approaching their art, if you like. You know, and one particular discipline is to almost anticipate the picture that you want to capture.
Hmm.
And that will be perhaps a case of you finding the, you know, almost like a film set. You find a frame that you think actually it'd be great if something happened within this frame, and you literally stand there and wait.
Yeah.
And it might be, you know, it might just be a person. It might be something, you know, that happens within that frame. And you are sort of, if you like, almost directing the shoot. I do that a little bit, and that picture that you cited there of the puddle with the lady with the suitcase. It looks like an air hostess to me.
Yeah.
That was a case in point. But most of the time, I'm wandering around and keeping moving.
Yeah.
And sort of, you know, if you like, sort of waiting for those moments to unfold in front of me.
Yeah.
You have to be quick to do that. You have to be quicker than, you know, than if you were trying to get something to walk into a frame that you've already sort of imagined.
Yeah. So you did a TED talk a few years ago, which is really interesting, and you discussed the sort of issue of privacy around taking, you know, photographing strangers and children and things like that, and the considerations you've had to take into account when doing that. Can you explain a bit about that and how you kind of overcome the hurdle of photographing people and putting a lens in people's faces when they may not necessarily know?
Yeah. Well, you would think. I mean, the whole talk was about the fact that you'd assume that. You know, people's sort of desire for privacy, and social media, and the fact that I don't ask permission to take people's pictures, because then you basically lose that moment, you lose the sort of the natural and, you know, the natural sort of essence of the picture, but also the, you know, the sort of the true likeness, or the true sort of true person, if you like.
Yeah.
So you would think that if you brought all those things together, that you'd be asking for an awful lot of trouble. But actually, what's happened is, particularly on Facebook, is that my page has actually sort of developed a life of its own. In that it's very unusual for the people in my pictures not to eventually find themselves.
Yeah.
And that also kind of sparks, it ignites a dialogue underneath those pictures of people's own recollections of that particular place or. Yeah. That particular person. And I think because people can see it in context of a greater sort of project, a larger project, there isn't that sort of objection too much. I mean, I've had a few people obviously that say, look, can you take a picture down? But in a lot of cases, it's because they're not in the place that they should have been, or with the person they should
have been. Gosh, yeah, I bet you do get a bit of that. Well, I mean, I scour the pictures to one day hope that I'll spot myself. I'd love to be in one.
It's crazy that people, you know, I mean, it's now got to a stage where, you know, people actually want to appear in the pictures, which is lovely. I mean, you know, I'm particularly flattered by that sort of development.
Yeah, I think in the past I've recognised there's been two occasions where I've known the person and I've tagged them and they've been absolutely delighted to meet.
Yeah.
That was Martin Bond talking about what he refers to as a human safari, taking a beautiful portrait photo of Cambridge every day since 2010, for 11 years and counting. His project is called A Cambridge Diary. And you can see his pictures on Facebook and Instagram if you search A Cambridge Diary. And if you spent any time in Cambridge over the past 11 years, you never know, you might spot yourself. More of that coming up. You're listening to BBC Radio Cambridgeshire and me, Emily Martin. Now, it's time for the second part of my chat with Cambridge photographer Martin Bond. He's taken a photo of Cambridge, a beautiful portrait photo, every day since 2010. I'm not even joking, every single day. And I asked him, will he ever stop doing it?
I had planned to stop on the 10th anniversary.
Oh, wow.
Which was, I think it was the... Well, it's sort of the beginning of March last year.
Yeah.
Well, if you recall, that there was something else going on.
Oh, yeah, I think I know, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I thought, well, look, you know, that now is not the time to stop taking pictures, because obviously, Cambridge, is, like everywhere else in the world, is going to change as a result of the pandemic, and I want to try and capture that for posterity. But also, my plans after I stopped publishing a picture every day was to go on a lovely extended holiday, and of course I couldn't do that either.
Yeah.
So my hands were tied a little bit, so I had to continue doing it, and I'm glad I did. And now I can't really see a time when I will stop. You know, I might at some stage release myself from the mandate of doing it every day.
Yeah.
But that is my kind of USP. Nobody else is doing a picture every day. So, you know, it's quite easy to dip in and dip out in a project, but to actually have that sort of discipline, I think is quite unusual. I'll just keep going, I think.
In terms of the lockdown and the pandemic, there's less going on and less people around. What's that kind of done to your creativity and what you've been able to capture? Have you noticed unusual things?
Yeah, I mean, it was to be expected that lockdown was going to be a challenge for me. Because there's just so little going on in the town, with all the shops closed, and there's really been sort of little to photograph in terms of people. You know, humans have become sort of absent from my pictures. But as a result of that, a couple of things have happened. One is that I've sort of discovered this sort of more subtle sort of aspects of the city. The secret side of Cambridge actually has been revealed to me through that sort of forced slowing down of the pace of life. And a good example of that is, you know, the peregrine falcons that I photographed last year mating, giving birth, and hunting.
Yeah.
Bang slap in the centre of town, which I wouldn't have been able to have photographed without lockdown, because because the traffic, the level of ambient noise around that area was such that you couldn't hear what was going on.
Right.
So I was able to sort of hear and sort of prepare myself for the shot before they emerge, which, you know, wouldn't have happened. The second thing that's happened is really that I've discovered the sort of the countryside around the city.
Mm.
So I've actually sort of ventured beyond, you know, places like Grantchester and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And again, you know, the silence has revealed this sort of, the beauty of the countryside, not just to me, but I'm sure to everybody else, and particularly the Fens. You know, we live in quite a sort of a spectacular place, really, being in Cambridge. And even though it's sort of, you know, flat, the skies are amazing. So I've kind of discovered landscape photography in a way, which I think in the fullness of time, most photographers do finish up discovering. I think probably it is one of the sort of, the classic forms of the art.
Yeah. Well, I'm a big fan of yours, as you know, and of your pictures. And some of my favourite pictures, I think, are probably Like, there's one of a girl in a like a blue satin dress, like walking away, and there's like a man in the foreground, and you can sort of like imagine what the story might be. And then you've also got one that's like a little girl with a balloon and like twinkly Christmas lights, which I think looks like it's on Sydney Sussex Street. I wondered, do you, I know this is probably impossible to ask you, but do you have a favourite photo that you've taken, or a particular one that if somebody was like, what's your best one, what do you think of?
I do have one photo that does sort of always spring to mind, and that is a picture of there is a low wall at the front of Trinity College, which is where they have the Newton tree.
Yeah.
And there was a gardener on his knees, you know, just tending to the borders alongside the pavement. So all there really was his shoulders and his head, you know, poking above the wall. The low wall.
Yeah.
A very, very young child, not very good at aging children, but I suspect probably about three, maybe.
Uh-huh.
Three or four, pushing his own sort of buggy, because his mother was just out of shot ahead of him. And he stops and has a conversation with this gardener. And the little kid is holding his hands up like he's almost describing or sort of discussing with the gardener some sort of aspect of horticulture, and the expression on the gardener's face is just sublime. You know, in that moment, that young, that child brought so much joy to that chap, that it's so evident that it's just that it was that split second timing, and I think probably that's why I like it so much.
That was Martin Bond talking about his beautiful 11-year and counting collection of a portrait photograph of Cambridge taken every day since 2010. You can see his pictures on Facebook and Instagram if you search A Cambridge Diary, and you might even spot yourself in one of them. I've spotted people I know before, and as I said to Martin, they love it. I would love to feature in one of those pictures. Not only are they just gorgeous pictures of Cambridge, but they're like the pictures you'd want of yourself. If you could kind of like, if you could set something up. Anyway, love it.